I hope everyone's surviving recent events in our country. Things are insane right now. As long as there are tortoises, we're gonna be okay. And we wanna make sure we attack a problem.
It was weeping some pus when I pushed on it
immediately upon seeing it.
And I put my nose up to it like this. It had like a necrotic odor, almost like death.
Oh, she felt that a little bit. It's okay, girl. Oh boy, oh, that's a problem. That's not good. Oh, that's not good.
Okay, so basically, guys.
Hey, I'm sorry, bud. Hey, there she is. It's Darwin, guys. How you guys doing? Just wanted to say hello and tell you what we're gonna be doing today. We are actually gonna be doctoring up Darwin. This little gal, or big gal, if you prefer, she got herself a little sick now, didn't she? I'll show you what's going on, man. So a couple weeks ago, I noticed some flies buzzing around her shell and right here. And it doesn't even look like much, but there was some flies kind of hanging around here and I was a little concerned and I put my nose up to it like this and I noticed it had an odor. It had like a necrotic odor, almost like death. So I knew she was infected. So what I did was I put a topical on it and kind of watched it. And then I noticed after a few days, it was weeping some pus when I pushed on it. Now, it's no longer doing that because she has been getting one round of injections already. And today we're gonna put the second round of injections in there. And I'm also gonna irrigate this to make sure that there's no dead tissue underneath the scute. But my guess, guys, is she got an injury on her scute. Okay, something might have fallen on her or she bumped herself. And what happened was it caused an internal injury underneath this keratinous layer, this layer of keratin, which makes up the outer scute. And it probably damaged her bone and got infected. She's still eating fine. She's moving around. She's acting normal otherwise. But this is what we do, right? We want to keep an eye on our animals and make sure they're doing everything normally. And we want to make sure we attack a problem immediately upon seeing it. So I feel very good. I think she's gonna be okay. Tortoise shells are designed to kind of get a little banged up. You can see there's a little bit of bruising there, old wound there. Here's another bit of a wound, but there's nothing, nothing else that is necrotic or smells bad, just this one area right here. And it doesn't, like I said, it really, there it is. It doesn't really look like much, but you know, the shell, the scute is pliable here, and we want to make sure we dock this up. Hey, that's my foot. What are you doing? Oh my gosh, these guys get so excited, my galops, for food. I don't know where Nostradamus is. We'll kind of keep an eye on him too. I like to keep an eye on all the animals here, as you can imagine. So I'll tell you what, we're going to go inside and we're going to prepare the medication, and I'll show you how I have to prepare it. And we'll bring it back out and we'll do the injection. So you guys are getting a little bit of a lesson on what I have to do. Of course, guys, I went directly to my veterinarian, Dr. Mike Gillen, at Palm Beach Gardens Animal Clinic, PGA Animal Clinic, and boy, he really got me set up, man. It's awesome to have a knowledgeable vet working with you. I've given injections before, and I'm comfortable with it, so let's get to it, okay, guys? And we might even bring you a little treat so that you can have a little treat after getting your medication. All right, we're gonna go mix that medication up. All right, guys, so here's what I'm gonna do. We've got ceftazidime, which is a really good antibiotic. I like this stuff because as opposed to some of the other antibiotics you can get, like Abatrol, it's less hard on the animal. And the other cool thing I like about ceftazidime is that it actually, you don't have to administer it every single day. It's actually every 72 hours. So what we gotta do is we have to first take this powder and we have to kind of turn it into a liquid. We have to mix it up. And to do that, we're gonna take out our 20 milliliter vial, or rather syringe. I gotta get a needle on here. Okay, and I'm gonna draw up 15 milliliters of sterile water. All right, oh, here we go. So 15 mls of sterile water. We're gonna draw right up here. Just do that. Very nice. And there we go. It's got a little air bubble in there, no big deal. All right. What we're gonna do then, push that air out, flip, pop the cap. We're gonna go ahead and start by putting 5 milliliters. Into this vial. Okay. I'm gonna do the same thing. I'm gonna put 5 mLs in each vial of medication, of ceftazidime. And this stuff, by the way, as you shake it and mix it, there is a bit of a gas. So the next time I put the syringe in, you'll see what happens. Let's put the rest in here. Oh, so 5 milliliters in each one. Now, since she's such a big tortoise, she's got to take all this medication. So what I do is we now shake it up. Shake away, baby. Just shake this stuff up. You don't want any more crystals in it. It's got to be a nice, it's got to be reconstituted into a liquid. And that's what we're doing. So I just shake it, shake it, shake it, shake it, shake it, shake it. All right. And I got all the dosages from my doctor, from Dr. Gillen. And, you know, you basically the dosages are figured out because you have the weight of the animal and she's 350 pounds. And so basically you weigh her. And then there's a mathematical equation, which I don't know. But basically for this particular medication, you do that and it'll give you the dosage. So this stuff, I mean, she's taking quite a large hit because she's such a heavy animal, such a big animal. So now all I got to do is draw up the 5 milliliters that I put in each vial back into the syringe. But watch what happens when you put the syringe in. See that? See the syringe? That's gases. So you want to just be careful. You want to relieve some of that pressure, which is what we've done. Okay? And now invert the vial, gently place the needle in, and we draw up the medication. Look at that. There's my 5 milliliters. From one vial. Oh, we got a lot of medication. We got a lot of gases from the mixture here. So I'm gonna draw up all of it. I'll show you what I do. I'm relieving the pressure in this vial. See, it's really got a lot of positive pressure. But that's no big deal because I can just push it out like so. And just be careful not to get rid of too much of the medication. Okay, now we got our final vial. Stuff looks good. Oh, got a little bit of a leakage. No big deal. That'll happen. All right. Okay, and that is... just under 15 milliliters, but we'll be okay. No problem. You always lose a little bit in the mixture. No big deal. Now, the next thing I have to do is, since we've used this needle, it's kind of dull now. So we're going to take off this needle. We got a brand new one that we're going to put on so that I can get it into her skin very easily. Now, this can go intramuscular or it can go actually subcutaneously, which means under the skin. Now, I also have sodium chloride. It's just saline solution. That's pretty much what this is. So what we want to do is we're also going to use another needle and we're going to irrigate the wound. So basically, I'm just going to take a small gauge needle, place it in my saline solution like so. And I'm gonna draw up a full syringe of saline because this is gonna help irrigate the wound if there's anything kind of necrotic under there. We wanna clean that out. So we're kind of hitting it from both aspects. We're hitting it superficially on the surface of her body. And we're also gonna hit her systematically with the medication. So this is what needs to be done every 72 hours. Now I can do this actually every day. If I wanna irrigate the wound every day, I can do that. But since it's been getting hit systematically with the medication, I'm just gonna do it every time that I get a little bit of medication in here. And I'm probably gonna stop doing this in the next couple of days because it's starting to heal up and I don't wanna keep opening that wound up, okay? But this is something that has to be done at this point still. All right, very cool. So we got that ready, put our caps back on. We got this. I say we get back outside and we administer this to our pretty young lady. All right, let's get back outside. Okay, so you know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna grab a few pieces of cactus here and we're gonna keep her interested in food. She's such a big lady, this needle's not so huge. I want her to come out of her shell, so to speak. And I wanna also keep Socrates from bugging me. So I'll give Socrates some food. I'll give her some food. She'll be able to stick her neck out and we'll be able to get her some medication. Oh, there's socks. So here, we'll hook socks up. There you go, socks. You see that green stuff? That's cactus. Come on. All you gotta do is look. Look, 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 look. Come over here. There you go. Socks found it. No worries. Good girl, socks. Okay. So here we're gonna start first. I'll just put some, come on. Come nibble, nibble, nibble. There you go. Oh yeah, I guess maybe what I'll do, guys, is put you down and hopefully we'll be able to catch all the excitement here. Let's see, cause I'm gonna need my hands. So we'll keep her right by you guys. And I just wanna go subcutaneously. I wanna get it in some of the softer parts of her flesh. So again, I'm gonna just tap this, get any bubbles out like so, and we're just gonna pop it, boop, there you go. And I'm actually gonna take it and we're gonna go right here subcutaneously. Oh, she felt that a little bit. It's okay, girl. Oh, come on, make this happen for me. Here we go. Oh yeah, oh yeah. Oh, there you go, you did it, that's it. And see that, guys, none the worse for wear. She's just gonna keep on chomping down here. And this is kind of what has to happen every once in a while. Animals are gonna get sick and you've gotta be able to be comfortable giving them injections and figuring out, especially with these big galops, these bigger tortoises, how can we kind of get them out of their shell so we can do this? The best way to do it is kind of what I've done here today. You want to keep an eye on these animals to make sure that, hey, how you doing? Here, I got another one for you. You want to make sure that they're eating. You want to keep an eye on them. Your husbandry is going to be the best way to make sure your animals are healthy. And if you let things go too long, especially with reptiles and turtles and tortoises in particular, they, when they crash, they stop eating, they stop drinking, they stop moving, and they just pull themselves into their shells. And once they're doing that, things are not good, guys. You really can't let things go with tortoises. You gotta be very proactive once you see something's wrong. All right, let's go on over here to the shell. Remember this damaged area? So here it is right here. And what I'm gonna do is just very gently, I'm gonna place the saline solution up in here. You see this? There's a little bit, almost like an abscess. You see that, guys? So I'm just gonna clean it out. That's all I'm doing. Nothing too major. You're just kind of putting it in here. You see, that's deep. So there's definitely a deep abscess underneath this scute. And I'm talking weird because I'm holding the cap in my mouth. Anyhow, we're gonna keep doing this. I just do it in little jets. Okay, you see what I'm doing? See, I just kind of give it a little jet and that really helps clean it out. And she obviously doesn't feel this, but the good news is I'm not really seeing a lot of pus or anything else coming out of her at the moment. And she's onto this cactus over here. So she's busy doing that. And that makes me very hopeful. Makes me feel very good about this situation because she is in fact not in too much pain at all, to be honest. But again, there's definitely been an injury. And sometimes, guys, to be honest, it's a good idea if you're able to, you can kind of expose some of the shell by removing some of this outer layer of scute. Now, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to keep giving her the medication and just keep irrigating it with my needle here, because that seems to be really working. We're really pushing it in there now. And I gotta tell you, this is looking so much better just in the last few days since we got the first round of medication in. So I won't have to do this again until it's Friday now as I tape this, guys. You're gonna see this video on Sunday. So the next day I'm gonna do this is Monday. So every 72 hours, but that's pretty good. So we cleaned that out again, another looking just a little once over here, and she's looking pretty good. She's eating, Sox is eating. What do you say we go find Nostradamus? Let me get my cap back on, my needle, so I don't accidentally get poked. We don't want that. So you just put this back on like so, and you just twist them off, and then you can dispose of these, no issues. I think I hear Nostradamus. Should we go find out? Let's see. Where are you, Nas? Oh, I think I see him, hold on. Let's go see Nostradamus. There he is, look at that, man. Whoa, almost fell. Hey, what's up, dude? Look what I got. I got some cactus for you. I love these tortoises, and I've had them for so long now. Nostradamus, since August of 2004. If you guys can believe that. This guy's only 16 years old, and what a beauty he is. Just a great friend of mine, this tortoise. I've had him now in my care since August of 2004, like I just said, and he loves a good head scratch. What a guy. Come on. And I know it's a boy because he showed me. Usually these tortoises, when you're talking about giant tortoises, either Galops or Aldabras, have to be about 200 pounds before you can sexually identify them just by looking at them. The good news is a few years ago, Nostradamus flashed me his tackle box. So I was able to see that he was in fact a male. Now the funny thing about that is males in captivity, both of Galops and Aldabras, are very, very difficult to come by. I don't know what the reason for that is. Perhaps because back many years ago when these animals were being produced in captivity, they were being incubated kind of in the mid-range of their temperature incubation gradient. And as we know, there's something called temperature sex determination with crocodilians and turtles. So I forget if it's the higher temperatures. I believe higher temperatures in tortoises produce males and lower temperatures females, and in the midsection you're going to get a better ratio. Most of the time people will incubate for that mid to low ratio, because the higher temperatures, sometimes the hatch rates aren't as good, because essentially it's really warm in the incubator. So usually I incubate my guys at 86 degrees, but I know people that have incubated their tortoises at about 89, 90 degrees, which is pretty high. So if things get too hot, you can kill a lot of the embryos, but maybe because people were trying just to kind of go mid-range, there just weren't a lot of captive bred males born. So you could spend, if you wanted to buy a male adult Galop or Aldabra, you're looking at paying over $45,000, sometimes even $60,000, depending on the size. That's incredible. There's so much time and effort put into raising these giant tortoises and tortoises in general. They aren't animals that grow quickly, so that's why the prices of these animals are so high. Because if you could afford to buy one as an adult, it's easier for you to immediately start breeding. Personally, I really don't care. I just wanted some buddies to hang out with for the next 100 years, and it looks like I've got them. I think they're great. And Nostradamus, when I got him, was a little bit bigger than, oh, I'd say a baseball. And now, as you can see, he's about 150 pounds. Beautiful tortoise, lives out here. I don't have a female for him, but maybe one day I will get a female. It'd be so amazing, wouldn't it, guys, if we could produce some baby giant tortoises? I think that would be awesome. Oh, come on. Oh, good boy. I love how he uses that front claw, front leg. Come on, are you gonna do it again? Show everyone. Come on, show him. There he is. Oh, pushes it right down. Such a cool little tortoise. Big tortoise, I guess. He's getting big, that's for sure. I like to hold on to it and let them. Oh, that's a man. I love it. See, this stuff has fibers in it. The spineless prickly pear or nopales cactus has these little fibers in it, so they get fiber, but they're also getting a lot of moisture, which is fantastic because we're going to be heading into our dry season here soon. In fact, guys, the temperatures have already dropped here in South Florida fall has finally hit South Florida. Now, when I say dropped, it means we're probably not gonna see very many more 90 degree days. So we're in the mid 80s right now, but we got a nice cool breeze. It's actually quite pleasant, but it also means that it's gonna be time for me to shut down this section of the enclosure because I don't want the tortoises kind of wandering too far if we get a cold front moving in. As you can see behind me, all of these thickets, all of these plants makes it very difficult for me to get the tortoises out of there and into their heated shelter, which is on that side of the Great Wall of Tortoise. So basically, I think this is gonna be the last weekend where I keep that open, right? Oh my God, you don't understand. I mean, maybe you guys do. You watch this show a long time and you also have your own reptiles. But isn't it amazing when you connect with an animal like this? I mean, this tortoise is just, he's my favorite. I just love this animal so very much. The perfect shell, perfect beauty right here. And you know what? He is starting to get a little concaved. So, I mean, maybe I can, would you mind if I lifted you up a little bit there, Nas? I wanna show everybody kind of what to look for. Can you put your head in for a minute? I'm gonna just lift you, my friend. Oh, just a little bit. Oh, that's a boy, that's a boy. Okay, guys, see how big his tail is and how it's starting to curve? See his tail? There you go. So he is starting to curve down. All right, I know. Oh, come here. I don't want him to hurt his leg. Come here. Oh, right here. There you go. I'm sorry, my friend. Oh, boy. Oh, that's a problem. That's not good. Okay, so basically, guys, what we're doing here today is we're taking a look at Nostradamus, and now you know he is in fact a male, and I am now in fact confused because because he stepped on me in a very sensitive area. Anyway, are we still buddies, man? I'm sorry, I'm just trying to teach people and show them how beautiful you are as a male and what to look for, buddy. Huh? Are you okay? Let me check your rear end. Oh yeah, there he goes. I think we're okay, people. I think we're okay. I'm sorry, bud. I didn't mean to hurt your feelings. Come here. Was that a little, I embarrassed you, didn't I? By showing everyone underneath the skirt, so to speak. But he's okay, see, he's raising up and we're still friends. Good man, I love you. All right, I just love to teach and I wanna show you guys everything I possibly can about these animals. He's none the worse for wear. Hey, look at her, she's going four-wheeling. So good times, no drama with her. She's got the evidence of a very tasty cactus on her face. She's moving around. I'm not really worried about her as far as this injury. I think we caught it early and it didn't get systematic. In other words, the infection didn't get into her blood, which would have been no bueno. Because if that happens, it does not take long for a tortoise of this size to really get sick. They'll get sick quick, but then they just basically waste away. It could be months or just months before they finally die. And what a horrible way to just slowly die if you had an infection in your blood. Tortoises, to be honest, guys, are really strange. Sometimes they're so tough that they can survive and deal with injuries that you wouldn't think they would be able to. Then other times, they get sick, and before you know it, they're gone. One of the ways that happened to me, actually, with the brother of Nostradamus, I actually had two Aldabras, and about a year into owning them, I noticed one was not moving and acting strange. So I brought it to the vet, and turned out it had pneumonia. The next day, it was dead. That was a horrible loss, but it taught me something. It taught me to be very vigilant, to make sure I spend a lot of time with these animals and make sure that I see them moving around and doing their thing. And as you can see, Darwin is moving around. She's happy. She's eating. She's climbing. We've got good posture on her because that's why we built this large water bowl. I drained it out. Don't worry, they're getting water, guys. It's just so important to really, really pay attention to these guys. Here comes Nostradamus over there. Very cool. Let's get them all close. Should I get more cactus? Why not? Let's go get them more cactus, man. I'm having fun hanging out with you guys. I hope everyone's surviving recent events in our country. Things are insane right now, but you gotta sometimes just chuckle, don't you? What a crazy world. Anyway, let's get some more cactus. As long as there are tortoises, we're gonna be okay. It'll all work out. Oh, by the way, there are tortoises here. We got the radiated tortoises hanging out. I love it. Let's go back. I want to get Darwin climbing. I love to see her doing this. It's so exciting when this gal's climbing around. There you go. There's a cactus for you. There's a cactus for you. Go ahead. All right. Hey, girl. Come on up here. Come on up here. All right. So I hope you guys learned a little something today. We did some injections on this gal. Pay attention to your animals. They're going to tell you everything they need. And you got to be on the lookout for anything strange. So if it's strange, if it isn't part of what you've normally seen with your animal, don't freak out. Just consult with your vet and be proactive as opposed to reactive when it comes to any kind of injury. And I think your animals will give you many, many more years of enjoyment. So that's what I got to say today, people. I hope you're having a fantastic day wherever you may be. Oh, sorry. And I just want to say thanks for joining me here on this video. And hopefully I'll see you guys again soon. We'll have more videos coming your way with our amazing animals here at Kamp Kenan. And maybe a few more surprises with some friends out there. Maybe a few collaborations on the way. So that's it. Have a great day. Stay safe. Be good to animals. Don't forget to like and subscribe. And with that, we are done. See you guys.